want to encourage you from the life of a young, rich young ruler. And when he was gone forth into the way, there came one running and kneeled to him and asked him, "Good master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said unto him, "Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. Thou knowest the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not kill. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Defraud not. Honor thy mother and father." And he answered, said unto him, "Master, all these have I observed from my youth." Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him and said unto him, "One thing thou lackest. Go thy way. Sell whatever away sad. But I want to encourage you as my brothers and as my sisters that you will turn to him this day, that you will yield, that you won't walk away sad, but that you will say, "Lord, teach me how to let go. Teach me how to do that, what you are asking for." So Father God, we exalt you, we magnify you, we thank you that you are a present God. We thank you that you are near, oh God. We thank you that you have never left us nor forsaken us. We thank you that when
this morning in my quiet time with the Lord in Mark 11, where it was telling the story of how Jesus was on his way into the city. He told two disciples to go ahead and he said, "If somebody asks you why you are untying this donkey, tell him the Lord has need of it. Tell them that the Lord has need of it." I came to declare today on this morning that the Lord has need of you. The Lord has need of something that's been placed inside of you. The Lord is asking you to yield and to surrender everything it is that you have been, that has been placed inside of you. The Lord has need of you on today. But I also came to declare that there is miracles, signs, and wonders breaking off in this room. For somebody, this may be a testing time for you. For somebody, this may be a time of just hurt and shame and sorrow and grief, and you don't know where to go. You don't know who to turn to, but this is your time to put a praise on it, amen? This is your time to break it off of you, using praise as your weapon. But for others of you, this may be a time of you have already come out. You're in a season where it's just chill. The waters are chill and you don't have anything to worry about. But guess what? Something may be on its way. So what we're going to do is we're going to put praise in the atmosphere. We're going to use praise as our weapon. We're going to use praise as our moment of exhortation to give God what he is due, to give God everything that he is worthy of, because he is surely worthy to be praised. this morning. Hallelujah. So today we just come to give God all the praise, honor, and glory. And I come to declare that there's a miracle in this room. With my name on it. Yes, there's a healing in this room. And it is here for me. Oh, 'cause there's a breakthrough in this room. And it's God. We
on, somebody.
I just gotta use my mouth. I just gotta shout out a cry of war. This is a war cry in this place. You ought to open up your mouth and shout.
Come on, we might as well play some more poems. It's a song, you know, I promise y'all gonna help us sing it. Come on, everybody clap your hands. Blessed be the rock. Yes. Anybody want to go deeper into the presence of the Lord?
Yes. Thank you.
Oh, can y'all hear me? I said, anybody want to go deeper into the presence of the Lord?
Yes.
Listen, as we are here celebrating Palm Sunday, as Jesus rode into Jerusalem, can we just ride into his presence with praise? Father, we want more of you. Our desire, our heart longs to go deeper in your presence.
Follow him, we have to take up our cross. And every time I read that, especially when it says deny yourself, it kind of hits me, because it's like, what does it mean to deny myself? Deny the things that aren't of God. Deny those thoughts that are not of God, because Lord knows we have thoughts that are not of God, and we need to correct that. And I'm talking to myself, because if we are expecting to go deeper with God and we're asking God to take us deeper, we need to let go of those thoughts that are not of God. We need to take hold of his word. We need to meditate on it constantly. We need to take God everywhere we go, no matter where we're going, work, home, church, in the car, doesn't matter. We have to hold on to God. If we're saying we want to go deeper, that means go deeper in your word. Go deeper in your prayer. Go deeper in trusting him. And I know that it can be difficult, because sometimes we focus on what we see and not on the things of faith that we don't see. So God, I ask you to help me take up my cross. Lord Jesus, teach me how to deny myself. Teach me how to walk away from the things of this world and to trust you wholeheartedly. Jesus, give me the strength to trust you wholeheartedly. And God, I pray that for everyone in this room, Lord Jesus, teach us all how to trust you wholeheartedly, no matter what is going on in this world, no matter what is going on in our lives, no matter what is going on in our mind, Lord Jesus, teach us all to trust you wholeheartedly, no holds barred. Teach us how to take up our cross and to follow you, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, I thank you so much for everything that you are. You help us all to go deeper in you. Thank you, Jesus.
Sing, I will fall.
Come on, continue to worship him. Continue to worship him.
Let your word be a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
I will follow you.
Order my steps, O Lord, and I will follow you.
I will follow you.
Not my will, but your will be done, Lord.
I will follow you.
Come on, continue to worship. There's a breakthrough anointing right now. Go deeper, come on.
I will follow you. I will follow you.
Lead me and guide me, God.
I will follow you.
I will follow you.
I will follow you.
pray for each and every person in this sanctuary and those that are watching online. We bind the hand of the enemy right now in the name of Jesus. We plead the blood of Jesus over every person in this place. We tell every foul and unclean spirit to be cast out in the name of Jesus. Relinquish that hand upon that brother, around that sister right now in Jesus' name. I decree liberty and freedom right now. I speak breakthrough right now. I speak clarity over that situation right now in the name of Jesus. Father, have your way in this place. You have declared that we have a spirit of liberty. I pray for that spirit of liberty now to take over this sanctuary, over the airwaves right now, Father God. Have your way in this place, Father. Touch the man of God that will preach your word. Let him come with power, with boldness, and with authority, Father. I pray now, Father God, as we are experiencing your presence, experiencing your breakthrough power, I pray that you will continue to minister to us throughout this service. Now, Father God, may you receive all the honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Can we give him some praise this morning? Can you let him know you got your breakthrough? Situation. Can you let them know that you're ready to go through and take that next step? Can you let them know you're ready to go deeper? Give them some praise this morning. Buzz fellowship time. Go to your neighbor, to your right, to your left. Welcome them into the house of the Lord. We welcome you that are watching this morning. We pray, we thank you for joining us.
Of welcoming our first-time visitors with us here today. If you are a first-time visitor, if you could just raise your hand, I'd like to acknowledge you and welcome you to New Covenant. Yes? Oh, awesome. Amen. Praise the Lord. Welcome, welcome. We welcome you here to New Covenant. Thank you so much for choosing us as your place of worship today. If you can, after service, just stop out at our guest and membership services. We have a small token of our appreciation for you choosing New Covenant as your place of worship today. If you're watching us via Facebook or YouTube, and this is your first time joining with us, we welcome you and we thank you for choosing New Covenant as your place of worship today. We pray for you all that you are blessed by the word and that you'll come back and join us again soon. So New Covenant, let's give our first time visitors and viewers a round of applause. Amen. Amen. All right, I'm going to run through some quick announcements and just some reminders for you. We are still taking candy donations. We'll be doing that up until Wednesday. You can bring them and drop them off in the basket if you like during the week. And if you would be so kind, you can also volunteer to help stuff those eggs. We're looking for individually small wrapped candy so that we can stuff into eggs for our young ones to enjoy on Easter morning. That's going to be on Wednesday. Here at New Covenant, just come out and help us stuff those eggs. Also, during our service next Sunday at our 8:30 service, we will have childcare available. It's going to be from infants through first grade only for that first service during our 8:30 a.m. service. We invite you to come out and fellowship with us, and we didn't want you to not have a place for your kids that morning. So our children's ministry will be open again, taking those from 6 weeks to first grade down in our children's wing in the hall down to my right, your left, in our 8:30 service. So you don't want to miss that. Also, on April 7th, our baptism service will be happening at, praise the Lord, y'all clap for baptism, amen, amen. For those of you that have signed up, thank you, we appreciate it. Hopefully you've been contacted by Pastor Tony. If not, send us your information and he will connect with you to let you know how you can be a part of that baptism class on it's April 7th at 4 p.m. at the Renaissance Point YMCA, or you can stop at our class on Saturday, April 6th here at New Covenant, and we will teach you all about what you will be experiencing on April 7th. So if you haven't done so already, you can stop out at our guest and membership services and sign up for that baptism class. Also, on April 14th, we will be having a ministry fair. You have heard several ministries come out and give their spotlight about what's going on with them, and we pray that you've been blessed by that. You've also been given the opportunity to purchase a shirt for us to wear on that day. It's Sunday, April 14th. The link is coming to your screen now. You can scan the QR code to purchase your shirt. If that's too small for you, just stop out at Guest the Membership Services, and they can help you there. Get your shirt. We're all going to wear them as a church on Sunday, April 14th. In addition to that, we're going to have our ministry fair and then take a group picture as well on Sunday, April 14th. We don't want you to miss that, so be a part of it. Stop out at Guest and Membership Services or scan the QR code to get your shirt today. Then also, we have our diabetes class that's taking place. You still have time to sign up. You can scan that QR code, or Miss Liz will be out at the kiosk after service today. You can sign up with her to take part in our pre-diabetes and diabetes class. We're in partnership with our Impact Center as well as Parkview Health. We want to make sure that you have all the information you need to know to stay healthy and to prevent diabetes. Finally, we have a video from our middle and high school students. They want to tell you a little bit about what they've been doing. So we pray that you're blessed by the video. After that, we'll have Pastor David come back and take up our offering. Be blessed.
Amen. Can we give the Lord a hand clap of praise for all that's going on at New Covenant? Well, it's Holy Week, y'all. You ready? Yeah, we're celebrating Palm Sunday today. It's Holy Week. Let's get excited for what we're about to celebrate this week. How many know we ate? Back in February, you all got more hyped about the Super Bowl week, and none of you even had a team playing. So let's get excited for Jesus as we're getting ready to celebrate His resurrection, His life, His ministry, and what He's done for us. Amen. Well, just to touch up a few things we want to announce. As you can see, Pastor Luther is not with us. He is out ministering down in Nashville at our sister church, doing a pastoral anniversary. As he's down there ministering the word, we're still up here bringing in the presence of God and ministering to you as well. So just know, just keep Pastor Luther up in prayer as he's being lifted up. We want you to join with us on Friday, 7 p.m. at Greater Progressive Church, as we will be coming together for our Good Friday service, the Redemption Church with Pastor Khalig, New Covenant with Pastor Luther. We're all going to be there, and we ask that you come and join us, support Pastor Luther and the choirs. They'll be singing and doing a part of the message that night. Then we're coming back Sunday morning at 8:30. How many want to take Holy Communion on Sunday morning? All right. Well, we hope to see you at 8:30 in the morning then. I gotcha. 8:30 in the morning, we want you to, if you wish to partake in our traditional Easter service, partaking in the elements, the body and the blood, you don't have a choice. 8:30 a.m. We want you to be there with us. But if you want to sleep in a little bit with the little ones, do a little Easter celebration. Somebody said amen behind me. Hey, it's all right. We got 10:30 service. Come and join us. But we're going to rock out Easter weekend. We're going to celebrate. We're going to give praise and honor to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So join us. And this week is an awesome opportunity. Just as you did with Super Bowl week, you talked about stats, you talked about players, you talked about chances. Some of you, well, hope, God forbid, you gambled a little bit. But you took the time and effort to hype up the week, to talk about what was about to transpire over the weekend. So I want to challenge you this week. Hype up Resurrection Sunday. Talk about Jesus to somebody. This is an opportunity for you to be a witness, to share your personal testimony of what God has done for you, how he's brought you out, how he saved your life. If you've just been saved a couple of months, it's okay. Share your testimony with someone. And if you have an opportunity, bring them with you on Sunday and let them be ministered by the Holy Spirit with the hopes that they will come to the feet of Jesus Christ. Remember, the Bible says, I will draw men all unto me by my what? By my Spirit. So come, be loaded with the Holy Spirit this week and allow the Spirit of God to lead you to somebody that they can come to get to know Jesus this very week. Well, as we prepare our hearts, as we get ready to give this morning, we see all the great ministries that are taking place. We see the ministry fair, the T-shirt, We Love New Covenant campaign, the preschool going on, the children's ministry that will be ministering, that ministers to your children week in and week out. Every time you get to come in this sanctuary, you have somebody that cares enough for your children to minister to them. But how many know that all doesn't happen unless you and I do our part and give our part to the kingdom of God? So this morning, as always, there are three ways you can give. You go to www.newcov.org/give and follow the online prompts. Or you can text give to newcov, give to newcov, to 888-364 give, where that's 4483. Or simply just fill out your tithing envelopes, place them in the baskets being passed around or in the collection boxes throughout the building. Have a way you choose to give this morning. There's no way we can outgive God. So, Father, I pray, as we still our hearts, our minds, and our spirits, you have spoken to us. Let not the voice of man intervene to determine the gift of this morning. But I pray that the Holy Spirit, as he hears from you on high, will speak into our hearts and into our ears. I pray that we listen and obey, Father. For the bottom line of our giving is nothing but obedience. So I pray this morning, let us be obedient to your voice. And I pray that you receive these tithes and offerings for the use of your kingdom. And that we will continue to ministry in this city and wherever you may lead us. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may come and serve God's people. Let us continue to worship and go higher in the Lord.
Amen. Listen, can we stand to all over this building while you're giving your offering? After you give it done, if you get done, get giving your offering. Can you give God an offering of worship, an offering of praise? Hallelujah. Song just talks about Hosanna, him being king, him being Lord, him being the expected one. Anybody have expectation that God's going to do something for you on today? I said again. Anybody have expectation that God's going to do something for you on today? Now, I challenge you to add some initiation with your expectation. Come on, can you put praise in the atmosphere? Because the Bible declares that he inhabits the praises of his people. Come on, somebody welcome him in with with your praise. Come on, somebody, welcome him in with your praise. Come on, somebody, open up that mouth and shout hallelujah. Song says,
Hosanna in the highest. Let our King be lifted up. Hosanna.
Somebody, everybody help me say it. Say ho. You say it, Hosanna.
Hosanna in the high.
Let our King be lifted
up. Hosanna.
Come on, somebody give him glory. Come on, somebody shout hallelujah. We bless your name, Jesus. We give you glory, we give you honor, and we cry out, Hosanna. Come on, let's shout it out. Come on, say it. Catch on right now. Somebody raise it up, say, let our King.
Let our King be lifted up. Let our King be lifted up. Let our King be lifted up.
Come on, can y'all raise it up? Come on, New Covenant, raise it up.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Come on, y'all, ladies, let me say.
Hallelujah.
Somebody shout Hosanna. Come on, if you're grateful, somebody shout Hosanna. Over our problems, we want you to be lifted higher. Over every situation in our lives, we say be lifted higher. Oh, every situation that we're facing, financial, health-wise, in our marriage, be lifted higher.
Jesus, you be lifted higher. Be lifted higher. Be lifted higher. He said that he be lifted up, that he will draw all men unto him, God. So, Father God, as we lift you up, God, we lift you up on behalf of our lost loved ones. We lift you up on behalf of our lost family members. We lift you up on behalf of our lost friends. We lift you up on behalf of our lost children. We lift you up on behalf of everything that has been stolen from us, every person, every family member, everything that in our bloodline has been cursed, God. Right now, God, we come against those curses. We come against those things that have been planted, oh God, from decades back, God. And we lift you up, God, so that all will be drawn unto you. Let our King be lifted up. Last time, everybody say it out. Hosanna. Come on, put those hands together and bless the name of Jesus.
You, but I feel the presence of the Lord in this place. Anybody feel him? Now listen, if you know he's here, let me ask you this. I know we feel him from a spiritual standpoint, but let me ask you, if you could see him standing, if you could see him standing in the room, what would be your response on this morning? Because sometimes I believe because we can't see him, we feel as if he's not here, but he's here. Hallelujah, Jesus. And Father God, I thank you for your presence, God. I thank you for your presence. I often say it, but I mean it every time I say it. There's no place I would rather be than in the presence of His Majesty, for He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. That word I told you, it means owner. That means that he's the responsible one. Somebody gonna catch this in a minute. If he is Lord over your life, that means he's responsible for supplying your needs. He's responsible for the healing that you need in your body. If you know him as Lord, you gotta understand that he is the responsible one. So Lord, I thank you for being King of Kings, for being Lord of Lords. I thank you for being the healer of my body, the healer of my mind, being the one that keeps me when I don't even want to be kept, for being the one that when I want to throw in the towel, tuck my head and run to the hills, give up, jump off the cliff, whatever it is. I thank you that you keep me in perfect peace because I got a mind and my mind is stayed on Jesus. So you be lifted higher, higher, be lifted higher. Jesus, you be lifted higher. Hallelujah. Jesus, you be lifted higher. Ooh, can you lift him, y'all? Higher. Be lifted higher. That's my cry. Jesus, you be lifted higher, higher, be lifted higher. So, Father God, right now we thank you that you are here. And your word declares that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. There is freedom. Oh, there's the opportunity for all of my needs to be met because I'm not bound by anything. I'm not bound by anyone. I'm not concerned who's looking at me, who is not here. But God, in your presence, I lift up my hands and I extend my heart and say, welcome in this place. Welcome into this broken vessel. I know you desire to abide in the praises, in the presence of your people. So we lift our hands and then we lift our hearts and we offer up praise unto your name. Father God, we pray that you are pleased with everything that has taken place on today. And as we move forward, we ask that you give us receptive hearts, open ears, oh God, and clear minds to hear what you have to say on today as we encourage your people. We bind every distraction right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Every plot and plan of the enemy to steal our attention, we call it gone right now in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you, God, that we will feast on your word on today. And as a result of your word, we will grow into what you have called us to be. We love you and we bless you. And for this, we give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, can you put those hands together and bless the name of Jesus? Appreciate it, man. Amen. Boy, y'all know the Lord is good, right? Y'all see my wife gave me, right? Me, my lips was ashy. I felt them over there. I told you, Jireh, the Lord will provide. See? Y'all just waiting for big stuff. He'll provide the little stuff too. Amen. Amen. The Bible says laughter is good like a medicine. Some of y'all so stiff and so stuck, that's why you feel stiff and stuck. Because you won't open up your mouth and laugh. Amen. All right, Brother Stanley, watch it over there. All right, listen. I'm excited about the word today because I must admit that there was a warring that led up to the preparation for this word. Over the last month, I've been going through it, y'all. Been going through it about a month ago. I was down in my basement and I was doing some work, trying to get some renovations done and trying to get my little room, my little boom boom room set up in the bottom, you know what I'm saying, where I chill and do my thing. Man cave, maybe that's better than boom boom room. Y'all know what I'm talking about, right? Not Ray's boom boom room, right? So I've been down there trying to get things together right. And so, y'all, I fell off a ladder. I fell off the ladder. And listen, let me explain something. It wasn't the fact that I fell off the ladder. It wasn't the fact that after I got up, I discovered that my head was leaking blood. It was the fact that I'm 41 years old and fell off that ladder. When I say my man pride kicked into high gear, I was so upset at myself that I fell, right? And I just want to pause even before I get started. Some of you need to forgive yourself from falling, right? There's some things that you've fallen into. There are some things that you've messed up, some things that you normally can do with ease. Hear me, because I was on the bottom step. I was all the way at the bottom of the ladder. And so stepping down on the last step, my foot slipped. And then so not only did I fall, but I grabbed the ladder to catch myself. So I fell even harder. And so in my basement, there are unfinished walls in this particular room, right? And so if you know anything about unfinished walls, the power receptacle, it was unfinished. So I fell and I said, out of all this wall. Right. That's what I was doing too. I wasn't laughing. But out of all this wall, Lord, was it your plan for me to fall and hit my head on the corner and for blood to be leaking out of my head? Okay. So then I find out that I have a concussion, right? And me being me, if you know me, if I get my hands to doing something, I want to get it done. So the next day, I'm going to tell on a couple of people came over to my house and tried to help me finish some things up. So I should have been sitting down. I should have been laying down. But I got to get this done. And they offered their help. So come on over and help a brother out, right? So I'm in the basement, and it's by that third day that I realize maybe I'm doing a little too much. And I realize that the message might have been, you need to sit down. That's for somebody too. God, I don't know why you're giving it to me. Somebody, there are things that are happening in your life and you think that things are just happening just to be happening, but he's trying to tap you on your shoulder and tell you to slow down. And for some of y'all, he's trying to tell you to sit down just for a moment. Deal with the concussion for a little bit over a week, almost 2 weeks. Then it's time for us to take a trip
to Nashville. No. Let me go back. Another tragedy before that. So after I'm getting over the concussion, I go back upstairs and I'm trying to build out some things that are going to go in this room. And so the way I'm sitting on the floor, I'm turning and I'm working. And I must have been in this position a little bit too long. And when I tried to get up, I couldn't get up. And my back was stuck. It still hurts, y'all. Y'all, somebody praying for me right now, because if you wouldn't, I'd be screaming, because I've been dealing with this pain for, it seems like, 2.5 weeks now in my back, on top of having a concussion. The pain in my back starts to ease up and get a little better, then I'm taking a 6-hour trip to Nashville. And when I get to a hotel, me and my wife, after that first night, we wake up in the morning and I feel like I'm swallowing razor blades. I said, what's going on with my throat? It's just feeling like somebody is stabbing me. I don't even want to think about swallowing. And if you know anything, if anybody has ever dealt with strep throat, because you don't want to swallow, you just keep breathing, right? And then that dries you out. It was just all bad, right? Okay, you think that's it? No, not for me. So we get back and we're trying to deal with that, and we're taking medicines and trying to rest and everything like that. I wake up Saturday morning and I'm just broke out all over my body. I have an allergic reaction to I don't know what, because I ain't been eating nothing. I've been fasting. You know what? I was talking to my sister earlier and she said sometimes, it may not be an allergic reaction, but because of your fasting, it's some things that are coming out of you. Okay, if God give it to me, I'm gonna give it to you. Some of you need to fast and pray. Some of you need to push your plate aside, push away some of your familiar things, your fun, and pause and take a moment to surrender and submit your body and your will over to the Lord so he can extract some of the things that are not supposed to be there, right? He wants you clean, not contaminated, right? And some of us have been feeding our mind, our spirit, and even our physical body with things that are unhealthy for us. But I just believe that if we take a time to push pause back from our normal routines, God can come in and do what he needs to do. All that said, over the last couple of days, I've just been on pause. And today, last night, leading up to this morning, I said, okay, God, I understand what all of that was for. As I was putting the finishing touches on what I'm sharing today, I said, God, I understand what you are saying. Get up to do praise and worship, y'all. And I guess it's allergy time, right? And I'm just going to tell y'all, I'm just going to be doing this. It's coming out like sweat. I said, for real? I said, I don't know what's going on, right? But either way it goes, I got something to share with you from the Lord, and I believe it's going to bless you. Amen. I'm going to go on and give you my title out the top. All right. Somebody repeat after me. Say, the promise is still on the way. All right. So you didn't understand what I was about to say. So that's why you said it like you said. And now that you've heard it, I want you to take just a minute and think back and reflect back on a promise that you've heard. A promise that you received, a prophecy that was spoken over your life, something that made you excited at one point, but now you've pushed pause on it because it has not manifested as fast. Now, I want you to say this now. Say, the promise is still on the way. Matter of fact, this time, make it personal. Touch yourself. Say, my promise is still on the way. Let's go to work. If we take a moment and reflect back and I'm on our lives, I'm sure we all can remember or recall a season or a sermon, a church service, or a prophecy that was shared of something that you would accomplish, right? Somebody spoke something into you, a word that you received that God was going to do something in your life, or God was going to do something for you or through you, right? Something that you may have been called to do or to be. For many of us, it was some old lady in an old church who grabbed you and looked you in your eyes and said, listen here, son, listen here, daughter. God want to do something in your life, right? I don't know what kind of church y'all grew up in, but I grew up in a church where them ladies would pull you off to the side and they would speak some things over your life and those things would come to pass. Matter of fact, I'm going to tell you a quick story of a prophecy. We had been in my church, I'll say this. I grew up in a real small church in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. Matter of fact, it wasn't even in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. It was in Northport, Alabama. That would be the new haven to Tuscaloosa. And if I be honest, you saw this outpour worship up here in the musicians. Sometimes that was how many people we had at our church on a Sunday. Small congregation, right? But then there were other seasons that it was thriving because we lived in a college town. Roll Tide, it's all good, right? And so what would happen is when a musician came, whatever musician left, they would send another musician, right? And then so then for the next three or four or so years, we would have another musician. Then we have another musician. If y'all don't know, I started off as a drummer, right? Started playing the drums. I was playing all across the Southeast at about 5 years old with my grandfather's and my dad's quartet group, right? So at this church, on a Sunday morning, we would sing, and all you would hear was me playing the drum. No keyboard, no organ. Well, let me not say that. My granddaddy plucked a little bit. That's what he called it, plucking. He plucked a little bit, right? But he couldn't do the choir songs or whatever. So he do our congregational songs. He may do a hymn or something like that. But when it was time for the choir to sing, listen, not only did the choir sing without music, but we had a radio broadcast. So imagine a radio broadcast coming on. All you hear is drums and singing. You got to hear it in your head to understand that it shouldn't be like that, right? So the thing about when musicians leave in college and they send the next one is the last guy who we had, he was an introvert. He really didn't talk that much. And so he didn't send us nobody to the church, right? And so one Saturday, I was up at the church and I just hit this little chord. Broom, 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 broom. I mean, it was two-finger chord. Like, it was pathetic. But I said, Mama, that sound like Help Me Lift Them Up. It was a song called Help Me Lift Them Up. Help Me Lift Them Up. Help me, help me, help me. Oh, y'all don't want to have choir rehearsal with me? All right, old school groove. I said, it sound like this. When I tell you, those ladies rushed out of the choir stand. They put their hands on me. They prayed. They prophesied. And guess what? Ever since that day, I've been playing. So I want to, before I get started, I need you to understand that prayer and that prophecy is real. Right? There are some people that have been gifted from God to speak a thing over your life. And if you wait long enough, it'll come to pass. All right? I'm getting ahead of myself. For many of us, it was a prayer-warring saint who pointed and laid their hands and told you what thus saith the Lord, shared a word with you that connected with your spirit. It reminded you of something God had personally showed you, or what was said directly aligned with the word of God for your life according to scripture, right? That word of prophecy, if it's truly from God, can be locked and loaded as a promise. Hear me. I need you to understand that word that you received, if it's truly from God, you can take that thing as a promise. And one thing we know about God's promises is this, that they always come true, right? God is infinite and zero, right? He's never lost. He's never failed. He always wins. He's always successful in anything that he does. He does not attempt. He only accomplishes. He's successful. And so if you're waiting on something from the Lord, be assured that it shall come to pass. You can look at it as a promise. You can look at it as a word of high value. You can look at it as a word that you can stand on. You can look at that as a word that you can look forward to it being fulfilled in your life. So on today, I just want to remind you for a few moments not to forget the promise, all right? All right, let's go. Somebody repeat after me again. Say, the promise is still on the way. All right, all right. I want to remind you that what the prophet said, what the preacher said, what the word that was spoken over your life, it shall come to pass. Why? Don't lose your faith. Why? Don't lose your hope. Why? Because there is purpose in your promise. All right, I want you to understand that there is purpose in your promise. Some of us have heard so many things over and over again, and we have not seen the manifestation that we think that it's false, we think that it's phony, we think that it was a lie, but you've got to understand that there is something that God wants to do, but you've got to stay true to his promise. There's value in the promise. I hear someone asking, how do I know if the prophecy was real, right? Like, you ain't got to raise your hand. I feel it in the atmosphere. You know, when I was talking about that old lady, some of y'all saw that old lady. Yep, she sure did. Or you thinking about your old uncle. Let me tell you something. Ooh, Jesus. Be careful. Ooh. Be careful when you put your mouth on the prophet. Be careful when you put your mouth on somebody that said God said because you hadn't seen yet. Hear me. A drunk person can prophesy to you. Yeah, gifts, they come without repentance. Yeah, I've heard some drunk people that quoted the Bible, and I'm like, you can't even walk a straight line or hold and say a complete sentence that was calling off scripture, prophesying, and was on point. And so I want to make sure that you, and I ain't saying go looking for a drunk prophet. That's not what I'm saying. That's not what I'm saying. But this is what I am saying. Make sure that you don't judge. I'm going to leave it alone, all right? How do I know if the promise came from the Father or if it came from a false prophet? And I want to be clear here when I make this statement. God doesn't want us to be deceived by false prophets. Neither does he want us to be in disbelief of real ones. All right? It is not good for us to make our assumptions just because of what somebody else said. There was a prophet who came here a couple of weeks ago, something like that. And I heard some people kind of saying some things because of some things that they saw on social media. And what I told one of my friends, I said, hey, I think you should come. I said, because I believe God's going to do something in the house. And sometimes we view people or we judge people by a portion of something that we see on social media when we don't know the whole story. We don't know the heart. And even if they're doing or saying something that you might not agree with, that does not negate that God may still be using them. You got to understand that in every gift, there is this thing called development. Right? And one of the things that I can say, I saw a level of maturity in this particular individual that I had not seen before. And he even spoke of how God was growing and changing him. And I believe there were a lot of people in our city who missed the opportunity to get what God might have had for them because they made a judgment. Let's go to 1 John chapter 4. Let's look at verses 1 through 3. We're talking about this whole false prophet thing. It says, beloved, do not believe every spirit. It says, but test the spirits. Somebody say, test the spirits. Whether they are of God. It says, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. Listen, some of them gone out in the world, and some of them have crept into the church as well. All right. 2, it says, by this you know the spirit of God. It says, by this you know the spirit of God, that every spirit that confesses that Jesus has come in the flesh is of God. Verse 3 says, and every spirit that does not confess that Jesus has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard was coming and is now already in the world. I'm going to say this, and I'm about to read this next passage, and I want y'all to keep your minds open before we finish this scripture. And this is why we have to be careful that we don't pull out one scripture by itself and apply it to everything, because context is king, right? We have to make sure that what's being said, why it's being said, who is being said, all of that matters, lest we can take out little scriptures and just point them in any direction of anybody that we want to, and we can make it sound like we want it to sound. Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 21 and 22, it says, but you may wonder, how will we know whether or not a prophecy is from the Lord? Anybody ever wondered that? It says, if the prophet speaks in the Lord's name, but his prediction does not happen or come true, you will know that the Lord did not give that message. That prophet has spoken without my authority and need not be feared. Right? In other words, you need not respect that person. Now, I want to push pause on verse 22, and I promise we'll be back to it in a moment. All that was my introduction. Now, I'm going to start. Here we go. Today, what we want to emphasize in this time together, that Palm Sunday
is a fulfillment of a biblical prophecy, right? Palm Sunday is not just any other Sunday. This is a Sunday of an arrival of a promised event, right? Now, the power in biblical prophecy is that God has already fulfilled, continues to fulfill, or will in the future fulfill every single promise or prophecy that he has made. Somebody says, God has already fulfilled, God continues to fulfill, God will in the future fulfill. Yeah, yeah. In the future, if he has not already done it, or if he's not doing it right now, he will fulfill every promise or prophecy that he made. This is why I just told you to hold on to the fact that your promise is still on the way, because many of us have thrown things out of the way that have been said to us or shared with us because it has not happened yet, right? So now when you look at that verse 22, and it said that if it does not happen, if that prediction does not come true, then it's not of the Lord. But then now you have to factor in the fact time. You have to factor in that when a prophet prophesies over you, when a preacher prays over you, when a sister or a brother tells you what thus says the Lord, it don't happen tomorrow just because you want it to. How many of us can be honest and say that we've lost all hope about something that was spoken over our lives? I want to help you on this morning because you've got to always know that God's time is not your time. He is not running according to your watch, your iPhone, right? He's on his own times, and he does all things well. All right, let's go. Let's look at the prophecy that was manifested on Palm Sunday. Let's go to Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. It says, rejoice, O people of Zion. Shout in triumph, O people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and victorious. He is humble, riding on a donkey, riding on a donkey's colt. Now, this is what I want you to understand about this prophecy. You got to keep in mind that this prophecy, by the time Jesus pulls up in Jerusalem, this prophecy was 400 to 600 years old. Oh, that ain't funny to y'all? I know why it's not funny. Because some of y'all can't wait 4 to 6 minutes for something to happen. It said 400 to 600 years. These are decades and centuries of time that has passed. Listen, you got to understand what they were in expectation of a savior, someone to deliver them from the hand of the enemy, right? And some of y'all, you just received a prophecy that you had a little money on the way, right? And you still got a job, you still able to pay your bills, but that money that they said, you thought it was going to have more zeros at the end of that. So now you done got weary and well-doing, right? You got your nose poked out, and you're not operating in a state of faithfulness because it didn't happen as soon as you wanted it to. Now, let's be honest. Some of us have given up. I told y'all that the promise on the way. Some of y'all are giving up on that already. I believe that there are many Sundays that we come down to the altar and before the sweat on our shirt dries, we don't believe what we came down here and cried about. And there's nothing wrong with coming to the altar weak after week, but some of us keep coming to the altar week after week because we have no belief. We don't have any faith. We have trust issues with the fact that what the Lord said will come to pass. And so because you don't have that hope and you have issues with believing what he said, you find yourself always wondering if he can, not when he can. There's a difference of wondering when is he than thinking, can he? No, no, no. We know that God can do anything except for fail. Before the prayer ends, before the prophet's shirt dries that was praying for you, we've given up. Why? It's because we lack, there's a P word. Can somebody put it in the atmosphere? Patience. Anybody like that word, patience? I ain't think so, right? Patience is a, I'll say for me, patience is a scary word. Because oftentimes I want to do what I want to do, how I want to do it, when I want to do it. And so sometimes I find myself in opposition with the way God wants to do things. Not the fact that I'm trying to fight him. Well, you know what? If I be honest, when I'm not in alignment with him, I am fighting with him. And so are you. That's what happens when we are not patient. We find ourselves in a fight with the Lord's will, because his will is in alignment with his timing, not our timing. Can we be honest? Some of us need to repent for God's calling for the prophet, or for calling the prophet a lie, because the prophecy didn't align with your timeline. Again, there were things that have been shared, things that have been spoken over you, but because it didn't happen when you wanted it to, you didn't believe that it did. Deuteronomy 8:22. Again, it says, if the prophet speaks in the Lord's name, but the prediction does not happen or come true, you will know that the Lord did not give us this message. This is true. But again, as we're waiting for God's promises to be revealed in our lives, we have to have patience. Why is patience important? Patience is important for our hope. Because this is what you got to understand, that as long as you're still alive, as long as you're still breathing, there's an opportunity for what God said, what God showed, for what was spoken to come true in your life. You're not too old. I know it seemed like your time has come and gone. You say, I don't even think I have the strength to accomplish it. Guess what? God will partner you with a young buck who got some strength, and you'll still bring that thing into fruition. But you've got to understand that you've got to make sure that you have patience enough to trust God's time. And somebody say, I trust your timing, God. Yeah. Yeah. Somebody say, the promise is still on the way. Yeah. All right. Some 2,000 years ago, on Palm Sunday, Jesus, being fully aware of the events to come as it started off Holy Week, listen, it was no surprise what was going to happen on any of these days leading up to the crucifixion and his resurrection. He knew what was about to go down. But Jesus, being fully aware, he willingly entered Jerusalem, demonstrating his obedience to the Father's plan, as well as expressing his unconditional love for man. Aren't you glad that he loved you enough to go through what he went through? Ooh, I said, aren't you glad that he loves you enough and all of your mess to still go through with the plan, right? The Bible says that the wages of sin, that's what you are, of death. We're sinners, right? So we deserve death, eternal separation from God. But the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. Jesus, he thought enough of us to go through with this plan that he might not have wanted to go through. You have to understand there's a difference between you got to understand there's a difference between Jesus's divinity and his humanity. Jesus was in human form as he's riding into Jerusalem to be humiliated and, well, to be celebrated, only to later be turned around and be humiliated, right? But he still goes through with what he's called to do. His actions here clearly cause us to see that Jesus puts obedience to the Father's will before his personal preference. Sometimes I think we downplay that again, but we've got to understand that he loved us enough to go through what he went through, knowing that he would be mocked and beaten and cursed, spat on, nailed to a cross, and that he would not be able to retaliate. He still did what he did. Now, the question is, are we willing to be obedient on that level? Ebony, when she was leading worship at the beginning of service, when she was talking about deeper, she said that we have a responsibility to pick up our cross. Y'all do know that that's not optional for us. If you are a believer, that's not optional. And how many of us have been walking around living on borrowed time, neglecting the duty of carrying our cross? Jesus was obedient beyond what he felt. Yeah, Jesus puts obedience before his preference because he knew he had to fulfill a promise. What's your priority on today, right? Is your priority to do God's will or to make sure you feel good, and you satisfied, and you comfortable in life, and that things are going your way, and that you're getting everything that you want? But what about what he wants from you? And let me tell you, the primary thing that he wants from you is your obedience. What has been assigned to you that you refuse to stay or that you refuse to humble yourself that you can walk in and carry it out? What has been assigned to your life that if you take a look at it, you say, you know what, I'm going to pass on that. If I got to go through this, if I got to deal with them, I'd rather pass, right? What has been assigned to your life, but you have become fearful and afraid and is keeping you from going to your next level? I'll just say this right here. If I got to go through all that, some of us will say, never mind. But the reality of it is we've got to be willing to take on and carry our cross so that we can fulfill what God has for us. Jesus did not have that type of mentality when he was asked to be obedient to God. And we see this in several instances in the Bible. In Luke chapter 22, verse 22, he says, not my will. He says, but your will be done. Right? That has to be our heart posture. Right? I don't want to do this, if I be honest, which don't lie to him. That ain't what I'm telling you to do. But be honest enough to say, Lord, I really don't want to do this. Be like Jesus, say, if there be any other way, can you let this cup pass? But nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Because I understand that your will is good, your will is perfect. John 5 and 30, it says, I seek not my own will, but the one of him who seeks me. John 6:39, it says, and it is the will of him who sent me. This is his common language because he puts his father's plans above his feelings. He puts the father's plans above what he wants to do, before his preference. And that's the same type of posture we have. And we have to understand a thing about Jesus' submission. You have to understand that Jesus has all rights to say, I don't want to do this. There was a song said that he could have come down, but he didn't, just for me. I don't know if you ever heard it. Just for me, just for me. He could have come down from that cross, but he didn't. He stayed up there just for me. I don't know about you, but I'm so glad that he did. But as we look at that example, my question again on today for you is, are you willing to walk out and carry out what God has called you to do? All right, let's go. Let me see where I want to go. Let me say this. His relational posture towards his father is something that we should take note of, right? Again, he has all power. And this is what you have to understand. Because we have free will, we can choose to or not to do what God asks or even requires of us, right? You don't have to obey him. I recommend that you do. But you don't have to, just like Jesus did not have to. But because of his relational posture, it was a posture of submission. And so, again, it was an attitude that says, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. And his posture was that of obedience. And our posture should be no different. We have the promises of God the Father in the written word. So just like Jesus and God had communication about what was needed or what was required, we have the word of God. And we can read, we can study, we have as much access as we need to understand what God wants from us, what he wants to do through us, and what he wants to do for us. And we can trust his word because Numbers 29 and 19 says, God is not man that he should lie, right? If we be honest, many of us have a problem believing God's word. You ain't got to say amen or nothing. Don't even move, right? Many of us have a problem believing God's word, and it's because of what we talked about earlier, patience. I don't believe it's just that we don't believe his word because we don't believe his word. I think we don't believe his word because some of the things in his word, we haven't seen it yet. But the Bible says that we walk by faith and not by sight. So sometimes you got to focus on more of what he said rather than what you see or what you don't see. Right? Because if his word said it, you can rest your hat on it and know that it will come to pass. Numbers 23 and 29 is the proof that his his track record is flawless, and that everything he said, he will perform it, but we struggle to obey it. Why? Because many of us, unlike Jesus, we have father issues. And so when we talk about God the Father, sometimes that throws some of us off because we're so used to being lied to by our father. We've been abandoned by our father. We've been betrayed by our father. And so if you have father issues, I understand that it can be a little difficult, but you got to understand this father, our heavenly father, the perfect father, the flawless father, his record proves again, and his word reminds us day after day. If you take the time and read it, if you read it, you will see that everything that he says comes to pass, right? We struggle to obey because we have trust issues. We've heard so many lies from the pulpit. We've heard so many lies from people who said they were prophets. We've heard so many lies from this one and that one. So we have trust issues, right? But we've got to understand that those issues that you've dealt with, they may have come from the church people, but that's not a representative of the church. You got to understand, everybody in here has this thing called flesh. There's this thing called humanity, and all of us at some point in time are subject to error, right? And so we've got to make sure that we are willing to forgive when people error, and then we make sure that we keep our heart and our focus on God's word rather than just the people. Hebrews 11 and 6 says, and without faith, this is why you got to have, all right, let me say this. I said we have father issues, we have trust issues, but the reality is, ultimately, many of us have faith issues, right? And the Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 6, it says, without faith, it is impossible to please the Lord. It's impossible to please the Lord apart from having faith. And we have to believe that faith in God is the driving force of all of his promises. An unknown author said this, God's promises are like the sun. They don't need our approval to shine. I thought that was good. It says that God's promises are like the sun. They don't need our approval to shine. I'm laughing because that's just in my mind. I see some idiot at about, I don't know, 5, 6 o'clock in the morning trying to tell the sun not to shine, right? It doesn't work like that. Neither do God's promises. His promises are yes and amen. His promises will happen. His promises will come forth. His promises will manifest as long as you are in alignment with what God says. The promise is still on its way. I want to share a few points, and then I'm going to get out of here. My first point is while you wait, you must have expectation and initiation. Somebody say expectation and initiation. All right, so if we look at expectation, we'll say that expectation equals faith, right? When you are expecting something, you have faith, you have a hope, you have a belief that what has been spoken, what has been shared, what you have seen, you think that it's going to come to pass, or you believe, or you hope, or you have faith that that's going to come to pass. Then you have initiation, and that's works or action. This is the work, the working of the faith in order for the expectation to manifest. James 2 and 17 says, faith without works is dead being alone, right? And some of us have received promises. We've received words, but because you don't have an active faith, you've allowed that thing to die. Because you don't have a faith that is in pursuit of what was spoken, you are in this place and you've given up hope and you feel like it won't manifest, it won't come to pass, it's not going to show up in your life. You feel like it's a lie, but the truth is that you've got to understand that faith without works is dead. You've got to work your faith. Faith must be put into action. Faith is not just, again, we say expectation. Ooh, I'm expecting. A lot of us been expecting for a long time, haven't we? You ain't got to say amen loud. I know y'all in here with me. Been expecting some things from the Lord for a long time. But the reason you've been waiting for a long time is either one or two reasons. Just because God may not have done it yet. And then for some of us, it's overdue. But you hadn't put no action behind your faith yet. And you waiting on God, or you think you waiting on him, but really, he's waiting on your faith to get in motion. Wow. Somebody say, my faith is in motion. When it comes to the promises of God in your life, if James 2 and 17 is true, this means that expectation without initiation can equal promise assassination. Hear me. It did rhyme, and, you know, that was a part of the purpose, too. But I want you to hear what I really said, though. If expectation, faith, does not have initiation, the work that goes along with it, it can be promise assassination, meaning that the promise God has for you will pass you by. Or can I say, there are so many promises that are neatly tucked away in the graveyard because people never bought into the fact that there was something that they had to do besides just wait on God. Some of us are living miserable lives on this earth because we just waiting on God. That's not the design. That's not the plan. That's not the agenda. That's not what it is. If you have faith, if you have hope, but then you put work with that, you will see some things that, man, God wants to bless you abundantly. He wants the best for you. He wants you to have so much. And when I say so much, I'm not talking about just money. Some of you are dealing with so much turmoil and frustration, and he wants you to have peace. Some of you are dealing with things in your body, in your finances, in your family, and the faith that you need is there, but you have no action to pair and partner with it. And those things that God wants to do, they are on the shelf waiting for you, and he wants to give them to you. He wants to bless you, but you got to have an active faith. Let me say it like this. When there is no faith activation, it can lead to promise expiration. Again, they said that one of the richest places on our earth is in the graveyard of promises, of dreams, of things, of assignments that people never really did. Somebody say the promise is still on its way. But you got to work your faith. My next point, I'm moving along, y'all, is his promises are found in his word. Somebody say his promises are found in his word. Yeah, I want to be clear when I say this. God hears our prayers. He does, right? The song says he hears your faintest cry and he'll answer by and by. He says all that, right? But more than he is going to respond to your cry, he's going to respond to his word, right? I need you to understand, not only will he respond to his word, but he is bound by his word. Yes, you can cast your cares on him because he does care for you. And I recommend that you do so. But after you cast your cares on him, I need you to make sure you call out some word to him too, so that he can release, that he can take your cares and release whatever else he has promised for you. Amen? Because ultimately, what ultimately causes God to move is his word, not your emotions. When you are sick, you can say, I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. You can say that until you die. But if you want Jehovah Rapha to be attentive to the needs of your body, you got to put some scripture on that thing. And you got to go to Isaiah 53 and 5 and say that he was wounded for my transgressions and bruised for my iniquity, right? You got to say that by his stripes I am healed. Right? His word will cause him to move on your behalf. Now, let me say this. Even when it comes to him responding to your word and him being bound by it, he's bound to his word, not bound by your timeline. There's still that patience. There's still that wiggle room that you got to allow him to be God. You still got to allow him to be God, right? Amen. When you're broke, don't complain. Just say the Lord in your word. Your word says that you will supply all of my need according to your riches and glory. Right? And it's not, sometimes we find ourselves saying things that contradict God's word and we mess up and dig ourselves in deeper holes. We got to make sure that we say things that are aligned with God's word. Amen. Remember, the quickest way to get God to respond is by calling his word to him, not whining and complaining. Right? He responds to his word, not your whining. All right? All right. Whether it be legitimate or not, I'm talking about your whining. He responds to his word. His promises are found in his word. Some of us are stuck in seasons of suffering, seasons of guilt and shame, stuck in poverty and lack. And while you're waiting on the Lord, he's waiting on his word. Let me prove it. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 12, it says this. The Lord said to Jeremiah, he says, you have seen correctly. He says, for I am watching. And this word watching means that he says, I am sleepless. He says, I am on high alert. He says that I am on the lookout to see that my word is fulfilled. Do you understand that God is waiting to hear his word call back to him so that he can respond? No, I'm talking about to you. You don't get it? I said, God is waiting for his word to be called back to him so that he can respond. There is nothing that you have faced in life. There's nothing that you will face in life that the remedy is not in the book. But he's waiting on his word so that he can make haste to perform it. Wow. My God, that's good stuff. His promises are found in his word. Next point. The enemy's objective is to get you to disagree with God's promises. I'm going to say that one again. The enemy's objective is to get you to disagree with God's promise. Anybody ever find yourself saying things that you know, I probably shouldn't say that because that doesn't align with the word of God? Anybody? All right. We got the super saved, sanctified saints. They always say what the words are. We got the walking thesauruses and amen. All right then, Bible talkers. All right, listen, Satan wants this from you. He wants you to solely focus on what you see. Hear me. He wants you to focus on what you see because what you see, it can be the thing that will mess you up. Sometimes we get messed up not only by what we see, but also by what we don't see. Right? Sometimes what the enemy shows you will distract you and it will detour you and keep you from walking into what God has spoken or showed you. But the Bible declares in Hebrews 11:1, it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Right? And so that's a contradictory thing if you're focused on what you see, because we are waiting on the thing that is not seen. That's what faith is. Faith is not fixing your eyes on the mark on the wall or the goal that you see before you. No, your faith is trusting God's word enough to know that if he said it, it will come to pass in my life, right? There may be seasons that I'm traveling on my way to the fulfillment of my faith, and it may be dark, it may be weary, I may seem alone, I may seem deserted, I may seem abandoned, I may not understand how I'm going to get from this point to the next point, but I have to understand that if God said it, my faith response is not to look, but it's to listen. Or let me say it like this, or if you're going to look anywhere, look to the word of God. Right? The Bible says that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. If you want to see something, see yourself looking in his word to see what he's already said about you that you may not have seen yet. And don't get worried because you don't see it yet. Just keep on saying what he said until you see what he said. Amen. Satan wants you to speak against God's promises. Why? Because faith comes by hearing. Hear me. Faith comes by hearing. So I said, Satan wants you to speak against God's promises. Faith comes by what? Faith comes by hearing the word of God. Faith comes by, and it says, and hearing by the word of God. If faith comes by hearing, guess what? If you hear in the word of God, your faith is going to be in God. But if you listen to the devil all the time, guess what your faith is going to be in? And so if you speak in all these negative things that are out of alignment, listen, you get paid on Friday, it's Thursday, and you like this, man, I don't even know what I'm going to want my check for tomorrow. It's going to be gone as soon as I get it. If you keep saying it, you may be denying yourself the bonus that they want to give you. Yeah. Faith, the substance of things hoped for. You hope for a raise, right? But it ain't on your check yet. But if you keep saying, it seems like every time I get paid, I might as well not even have a job. Some of y'all don't say it right. I'm just working to pay bills. You will never go on a vacation. Not because you can't afford it, because God can turn a little into a lot, but you keep speaking these negative things over yourself. We got to make sure that what we're saying does not contradict or counteract what God is saying about us. He wants you to speak out of doubt so that you can cancel out the promises of God in your life. He wants to get you to decree lack, loss, defeat over your life. And guess what? Soon after, you'll see lack, defeat, and loss in your life. He wants you to say these things. Why? Because Proverbs 18 and 21 says the power of life and death is in your own tongue. It's in the power of your tongue. Your words have power. Somebody say, my words have powers. Come on, say, my words have power. And say, I will speak the word of the Lord over my life. Yeah, I won't keep continuing to rehearse the lies that Satan is telling me, those things that he's planting in my head. Right? No. I won't be broke. The Bible says I am above only and never beneath. I'm the head and not the tail. I'm the lender, not the borrower. I don't see it in my account yet, but I'm the lender, not the borrower. You might can't borrow no money from me today, but I'll let you borrow some. I'll let you borrow some. I got some mints. Well, don't borrow that. Just have it if I give it to you. Right? So sometimes, listen, thank you, Jesus. Could that be faith, putting your faith into action? That you want to be the lender and not the borrower, but you don't have money, but you're willing to let somebody have something? And once you start to get on that routine of putting that faith into action, sooner or later, it'll manifest into the thing that you may have been praying for and waiting for. I don't know. I ain't say that's what the Bible said, but I say, could that be? I say, he said, if I just give, let somebody borrow my thing, he said, God was going, that ain't what I said. And that shows not what the word said. Remain faithful until the promise of God shows up. Let's go back to what we just read. For many centuries, this is Zechariah 9 and 9. You don't have to turn there, but I'm just going to expound a little bit. For many centuries, they had heard the prophecy of the Savior who was coming. But their belief had dwindled because of the time that had passed. Again, I say this was 400 to 600 years later that this happened. And Delacia said something when she opened up this morning. When it did come to pass, they were upset because the prophecy didn't happen the way they wanted it to happen. They thought the Messiah was going to come in swinging slingshots and shooting bows and arrows and killing everybody, right? So what happened is they celebrated when he saw him coming, but then they turned on him and said he wasn't who he said he was because everything didn't happen. He still ended up defeating their enemies. But because they were not patient enough to see the prophecy fully come to pass, they gave up and they turned their back on him. Who am I talking to in here on this morning? That there have been some things that you knew were true, that God has spoken over you. And when a portion of the prophecy manifested, but the rest of it didn't yet, they must. A lot of people who say everything. Right? Like, yeah. So many times we throw the whole thing away because we weren't willing to wait to see how the end was going to pan out. That's because we lack patience, just as a people, right? We lack patience, right? And so what I'm trying to say in all of this is, yeah, the promise is on the way, but when I say the promise is on the way, the underlying theme is you got to be patient until it comes, until it shows up, until it fully unwinds. So with that being said, some of you need to revisit the promise that you heard. Some of you need to review the prophecy. I shared in the first service that I have a folder in my iPhone of probably 60, 70 prophecies that I've received over the years. When somebody prophesies to me, I usually say, hold on, can I press record? And I record that thing, right? Because I'm finding out at even 41 that, you know, I don't remember like I used to, right? And so I want to make sure that I don't miss out on anything that God has spoken over me. And guess what? Sometimes I go back and I revisit something that I may have received 10 years ago, and I'm like, oh. I have that aha moment that what I'm dealing with right now, how God is moving in my life right now, a decade later, is in direct correlation with something that the prophet spoke over me, that the preacher spoke over me, that was prayed over me. So I want to challenge you guys. When a prophet, when the word of the Lord is coming forth on a Sunday, take notes. But if God sends something and it resonates with your heart and it resonates with your spirit, somebody speaks something over you, don't just say, oh, they just, yeah, you know. No. Because guess what? Sometimes you don't get what he said because you don't remember what was said, and so you don't act in alignment with what was promised to you. And so sometimes your behavior is reckless or out of alignment with what he promised to you because you didn't take it seriously. You didn't read it. You didn't save it. You didn't store it for a later time. All right, remain faithful because it shall come to pass. All right, let me say this, and I'm almost done. I got one more point. All right. Let me say this for those of you who have heard a word from the Lord or received a promise from the Lord. Maybe you're like the people in Jerusalem. You're like the people who've been waiting. Obviously, it hasn't been 400 to 600 years that you've been waiting. But maybe it's been quite a while. This is what I want to tell you. You got to remain faithful and focused. While you're waiting, you got to remain faithful and focused. And this is why. There's no worse feeling than seeing somebody else walk into your promise. Whoa. Something that happened last week, and I shared this in first service, but it just hit me for real. I don't know if many of you know that I write songs, and that's one of the things I know that God has called me to do. And many of you have heard me tell my testimony that I've allowed, honestly, and I stand up here and say I've allowed fear to grip me from releasing music. I've been writing music since I was 11 years old. I could play y'all 200 songs right now that probably could or should be on the radio, and they're just in my iPad or just in my iPhone, right? How selfish of me. How disobedient of me, right? Last week, I'm listening to this clip on YouTube, and this video is circulating around of this song, and everybody going bananas about this song. It's an old song, but it was rearranged in a certain way. And guess what? I did that like 12 years ago. And it hurt me so bad that I had to watch someone else walk in the obedience of something that I know God told me to do. And guess what? I did it. I play it for y'all at church if you want to hear this jumping too. That thing, getting it. It sounds better than theirs. I'm just going to tell you the truth. But guess what? I didn't work. I didn't let it fully manifest. And I don't know who I'm talking to that got the book, who wrote the play, who got the idea for the invention, for the person that there's a recipe that you know you've been trying to hold it on to yourself. And don't, listen, some of y'all are going to let this stuff go to the grave with you. Ooh, Jesus. Y'all do know I said that out loud, so that means I had to hear it too. We've got to make sure that we don't allow anybody else to walk into our promise. Why? Because we were too fearful to. Because we were too afraid to. That we thought we were too dirty, that we weren't qualified, that we thought we weren't worthy of God's promise. This is the good thing, y'all. It don't matter how bad you are. The Bible says that our best is nothing but filthy rag. Our very best. But then there's another word that says that we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So if you know, I just got to go here. So if you know what type of rag he was talking about, there's really no more filthy rag that's filthier than ever. He was talking about a woman's menstrual rag. He said, our best is as of a filthy rag. But guess what? There's nothing better, nothing cleaner than us being the righteousness of God. So this is what you got to understand. Our best is filthy rags. But we are the righteousness of God in. So you want to operate in your own thing? Or you want to do you want to operate in the fact that he's promised you that if you be in Christ Jesus, that you receive his righteousness for your wretchedness? Do you want to go in your own strength and your own power? Or do you want to walk in the fact that his promises for me are yes and amen? And it does not matter what it looks like, what it seems like, what it feels like, what they said about me, how they feel about me, whether they want to speak to me, whether they don't lie, gonna lie on me. It does not matter. Because no one controls you receiving your promise but you. Guess what? God is not even in control of you receiving your promise. He's no longer in control. Good. He's no longer in control. Everything God is going to do, he's already doing. He's just waiting on you to accept it, to call it, to get it. Oh, you're talking about blab it, grab it, name it, claim it. No, I'm talking about taking God at his word, because we just read that he bound to his word. Now, I've been known to lie, but I was speaking the word that time. I told you he was a man. No. Quit being deep. Last thing. This is my final point. While waiting on the promise, we've got to watch what we say. Tell somebody, say, watch your mouth. I'm going to try to move fast on this. Again, Proverbs 18:21, it says that life and death is found in the power of the tongue, and those who love it, indulge it, who appeal to it, they will eat the fruit. But I like this. It says, and bear the consequences of their words. Your words have consequences. What you say has a consequence. Either that consequence is going to pull you closer to the promise, or it's going to push you away farther from the promise. But what you say, what you speak, you will eat, right? Anybody know those people who could just talk themselves just in a mess, just talk too much? Nah, I wasn't going to do it, but I did my little illustration first service. I'm going to do it one more time because it's funny to me, so I'm going to make myself laugh. You remember? You know, you be at the table with somebody, you know, you got somebody across from you, you got two, three people, and somebody just talking just too much, and you about kick a bruise in they shin, like, Or if your kids, now your kids are the worst for that, right? They get to talking in front of everybody. Don't your kids want just to say the worst stuff about you when you get in front of church folk? When you at church, then they get to tell all your business, right? After church. That's why people get their kid out of church. Let's go. Because you talk too much, right? Kids just talking. And if your mama's like my mama, she hit you with this. Y'all saw it. I really didn't do nothing. But because your mama was like my mama, you saw it. She hit you with this. That's the equivalent of shut up. This right here. People who will talk themselves out of a blessing and talk themselves into a mess. And I believe this is why the psalmist said in Psalm 141 and 3, he says, set a guard, O Lord, over my mouth. Keep watch over the doors of my lips. He says, set a guard. I said this first service. Now, when I think about a guard, I think about a guardrail on the highway that keeps an 18-wheeler from going off the road. That's what you need over your mouth. When I think about a guard, I think about a big buff dude at the mall who's trying to keep the youngins from acting up. Right? That's what you need over your mouth. For some of us, it's true. That's what we need over our mouth. He says, keep watch over the doors of my lips. Tell somebody, just say, don't talk too much. I believe this is said so that we won't speak out of frustration. Remember, this point is, while we're waiting on the promise, we've got to make sure that we watch what we say. And so we don't want to speak out of frustration. We don't want to speak out of fear. We don't want to speak out of anger or rage. We don't want to speak out of our emotions, because our emotion will have us all over the place. And when we make emotional choices, that's how many of us mess up. Anybody ever messed up because you made a decision while you were angry? You sent a text message while you were angry? You didn't answer a call because you were angry? We got to make sure that we don't lead with our emotions, but rather that we lead with God's word. The promises of God are found in his word. The promises of God give us peace in trouble. We find that in John 16 and 33. The promises of God give us healing. We find that in Psalms 47 and 3. He gives us guidance and direction in Proverbs 3, 4, 5, and 6, right? Victory over sin, 1 Corinthians 10 and 13. He gives us strength in weakness, 2 Corinthians 12 and 9. He gives us forgiveness of sin, 1 John 1 and 9. And he promises us eternal life in Romans chapter 6 and 23. Salvation through faith in John 3:16. So I want to challenge us all on today. Let's stand. I want to challenge us all on today that as the promises of God come forth in your life, that as what God has said or spoken over your life, if you see it manifest, I want to challenge you to testify. Tell somebody. Some of us are very selfish with what God has done or what God is doing for us. But guess what? Your testimony of how God's promises came true in your life may be the very thing that helps somebody else's faith grow from this level to this level. They may be teetering on their trust and their ability to lean into God, but your testimony of that God's word did come true in your life may be the thing that encourages them to trust him in their life. I want you to make this declaration as we go. Repeat after me. Say, if God said it, that settles it. I believe it, and by faith, I receive it. Yeah, see, it shall come to pass. All right, now some of y'all didn't know what I was going to ask you to say, so you was a little nervous. This time, I want you to speak it with some confidence. Say, if God said it, that settles it. I believe it, and by faith, it shall come to pass. Last thing, never allow your temporary frustration to allow you to move or make a permanent decision. Let me say this again. Never allow temporary frustration to allow you to make a permanent decision. All right? Just trust that God still got you. Amen? All right. I want to open up the altar for anyone who may not know Jesus, the way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, right? Maybe you don't know Jesus in the free pardon of your sin, meaning that you have not accepted Jesus as the Lord and Savior of your life. Maybe there is someone that you really don't understand why I'm asking you to trust in this whole God thing, this whole Jesus thing. Maybe this is unfamiliar to you, but you want to get to know more about it. I want to give you the opportunity to make the best decision that you could ever make in your life. This is the decision that can put you on a path towards receiving all the promises that God has for you, right? We said that he said that we would be above and never beneath, the lender, not the borrower, right? We would be blessed going in and coming out. He has so many things that he wants for us, but these are the promises that he has assigned to believers, right? So if you don't believe in him, if you have not accepted him, all of what I've been talking about today does not apply to you. And I would not want you to leave this place without being in a relationship where you can receive access to the Father's promises for your life. If there's anyone who does not know Jesus as your Lord and your Savior, I want to give you the opportunity to come forth and accept Jesus Christ. He wants to save you. He wants to do something in your life to change you and show and prove to you that He is who we preach about, who we sing about, who we believe. Man, is there anyone? Hallelujah. Next thing, I want to open up the altar for someone who has given up on the promises of God. It's been so long since you've seen God do anything that got your attention. Now, we're not even going to look at the fact that you're breathing right now, that you got clothes on your back. But some of us are so focused on the big things that we negate the small things that He does. The Bible says, in all things, give Him praise. Some of us are waiting for the promise, the big thing, to give Him praise. But guess what? The small things deserve His praise too. But maybe, maybe you say, God, I know, I believe, or I hope, or I'm trying to do this faith thing, but I need help with it. I want to invite you down here. We'll pray the prayer of faith with you, that your faith would grow, that your faith would mature, that your faith would develop into a strong faith, so that not only will you be waiting on the promises of God, but you'll begin reading and seeking and posturing yourself to receive all the promises of God. I don't know about you, but I don't want just some of the promises. I want everything that He has for me, right? Maybe you've been wounded by something that someone said in a position in the church. Someone, they said something and you thought it was false or it was deceptive or whatever the case may be. I want to challenge you to try to trust Jesus again on the day. Well, you can't try it. You're going to either trust Him or you're not. But I want to give you that opportunity to come down here and we can walk you through that if you're struggling with that. If there's someone, if you just need prayer for something that's going on in your life and you say, God, you promised me healing, but I'm still sick and I don't see how I'm getting well. You promised, oh God, that if I raise my children up in the way they should go, they shall not depart from it, but they doing all kind of crazy stuff. And you say, you promised in your word, oh God, that you would supply all of my need, but I'm struggling to get by. If you're struggling with the promises of God, I want to invite you up here for prayer. Yeah, because He has a promise for you. It's something that He wants to do in you and through you. And this is my thing. For those of you who are still out there, before we leave, you can't just partner in prayer and hope and in faith and believing that what they are praying for and what's in your heart, that you may be ashamed to come up here for, that God will begin to do a work in your life. Right? I don't ever want to act like I'm just standing up here like I got it all together. Because if I be honest, this is the posture I should be in. But this is just the assignment for today. I come in here plenty of times through the week, and I'm not bragging about what I do, but I come down, I have to lay there because I don't have it all together. I'm trying to figure a lot of these things out just like you, because I want His promises. I want to walk in all of them. Amen. Is there anybody else? God specifically had me to put this in my thing. Y'all can see it. It says, don't rush altar appeal. So you can stand there and miss out, or you can come and receive what God has for you today. I didn't write that because I wanted to write it. But I believe that what you need is here for you on today. If you need peace, His promise is He'll give you the peace that surpasses all understanding. That's what He wants to give you. He wants to give you joy for your sorrow. Is there anybody else? Amen. Do me a favor. Can you just turn to your neighbor? I'm going to go old school like my pastor used to say it. Look at your neighbor, eyeball to eyeball. Show them teeth, gums, whatever you got in your mouth. Smile at them. Don't be mean to them. And say, neighbor, say, I want to remind you that the promise is on its way. Come on, look at your neighbor on the other side. Smile at them. Say, neighbor, say, don't give up. God's promise is still on the way. Father God, we ask that as we leave this place, God, that your hands of protection would guide us to our various destinations. We love you and we bless you for our time of worship, prayer and praise. and preaching on today, God. We pray that what was shared did not fall on deaf ears, that it did not fall on stony hearts, God, but that it took root, that those seeds took root in hearts that are willing to water that word, really willing to study that word, and willing to wait to see those words manifest in their lives, God. We thank you, God, that this did not go in one ear and out the other, God. But we thank you, God, that we've been fed with something, God, that we will, oh, God, allow to grow in our hearts and our spirits. And not only will it grow with us, but we'll share it with somebody. We'll encourage somebody. And even when it gets dark, we'll encourage ourselves like David and say that we know that the promise is still on the way. We love you, we bless you, and we give you glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be dismissed. Love you, family.